morning. Start by thanking Center for Educational Research and Training for giving me this opportunity. I have been assigned this topic, which is Muslim political assertions, thinking beyond secular anxieties and binaries. And I do have a paper, but I don't think that can be managed within this given 30 minutes. So what I will do, and probably for looking at the audience, which I guess must be from undergraduate to PhD, spread across various levels of competence and etc., I thought I'll probably keep it quite simple and have a presentation, make a presentation which probably ties up. So, yeah, with this caveat, which is that it will be a very simple, basic level. So one of the assertions probably we could say is that, let me put it across, that one of the things which was prophesied long time back was that with the notion of enlightenment, the light of reason, enlightenment, and with the spread of modernity, the deepening entrenchment of modernity, etc., we will all become rational. And the idea was that as a result, religion, which has already been relegated to the public, sorry, the private domain, will slowly become erased. Unfortunately, as in the classic phrase, which has been deployed by many thinkers, what we have been witnessing, on the contrary, has always been a return of religion. So the turn back towards religion, the return of religion. So which in a sense raises this question, which I'll put it very schematically and simplistically, as it were. So what is the problem here? Why do we have this return of religion? Is religion indispensable? Is it a question like that, that we are not yet? Is there a beyond where religion will be what you call ascribed to even a simple private domain or erased completely? The problem seems to be, to put it in its philosophical dimensions, that our lives, our languages are deeply enmeshed in theological theology has been what you call enmeshed in most of our languages, concepts, etc. To put it in another schematic and simple example will be that the notion of secularism, which is what one of the concerns here, secularism. So we are supposed to become secular, and the simple argument would be that secularism is impossible. Yeah, this is me speaking against the constitution, but not actually. We are supposedly a secular nation. Now, I'm saying that secularism is actually an impossible task. And moreover, secularism is actually the logic of capital. Secularism is actually the logic of capital. Why? Not only just a question of secularism is the logic of capital, that people always live and lived and believe in a question of belief, in a question of religion. Now, one simple way to understand is that now there are people, some of my friends even, who are willing to die for secularism, right? You can see the paradox. Secularism, which is supposed to supplant, to replace religion, has become religion. If you understand this paradox very carefully, that you can understand the inescapability of the theological question, that secularism has become a religion. People are willing to die for it. Right? So there is a problem here of a question of binary, and how do we think beyond this? So that will be one question, the question of difference. Second will be to make this claim that hence minority is the construction of modernity. It is not as if a minority exists anywhere. No, minority comes into existence as a result of particular conceptual frameworks, a particular way of imagination. I usually use this example from Salman Rushdie's Shame, where in the novel Shame, which is about Pakistan, by Salman Rushdie, he makes his claim, which has been proven wrong by many other people later on, but he says that, how did Pakistan emerge? We know that 1930s, the whole idea of Pakistan, etc. And from 1930s, quickly within 17 years, a whole nation is born. Right? Now, I'm saying that creating a new Medina is a work by somebody who actually argues that it is not hastily put together. Rushdie's argument that is that Pakistan was created just all of a sudden overnight. As a result, there was no sufficient thinking which has gone into it. Let me quote from Rushdie's shame. Rushdie says that Pakistan was just insufficiently imagined. Okay? This is the exact quote from Rushdie's shame. I don't have the page number with me, but I'm sure this is an oft-quoted line, that Pakistan was just, he uses just, was just, not the sense of justice or just, but just simply, just like that, just insufficiently imagined. So usually I counter this by saying that if Pakistan was insufficiently imagined, there must be a way in which India is excessively imagined. Right? India must be excessively imagined, because this is the logic of binary. You cannot have an inside without an outside. So once you create an inside, you automatically create an outside. You cannot create an outside without an inside. And you will see the limits of modern logic, which always depends on binary. A binary is required. So then Pakistan, India becomes a binary. For the configuration of Pakistan, Pakistan needs India. For the configuration of India, India needs Pakistan, right? So this excessive imagination of India is something that we are now, this is the problem that we are facing. So as a result, minorities, which I said is a construction of modernity itself, as a result of minorities, particularly Muslims, become the the internal and the external other. External other as embodied in Pakistan, and I'm not even talking the global level, but internally as embodied by the Muslims in India, right? So the questions of secular anxieties and binaries. So how do we think beyond this binary? Now, those who are familiar with the whole post-structuralist argument, what we do in such cases, inside, outside, what are the other quick binaries, normal, abnormal, majority, minority, rational, irrational, or religious, self-other. Self-other is one of the most important aspects of the philosophical understanding of imagining oneself. So you cannot imagine oneself without a notion of the other. Right? So this is the explanation of why I said that in terms of Indian nation, the Muslim becomes an internal as well as an external other. So there is a way in which in order to become more and more patriotic, you need this, you need to vehemently use all kind of things against this other. It's only by vilifying the other that you can have a self-assertion. This is one of the paradoxes of what you call India or Indian nationalism. Now, to rethink this, to reimagine this, to think beyond this notion of secular and also notion of binary, one may have to rethink the larger ambit or the larger frame within which secularism is contained. As I said, we can think of secularism as the logic of capital itself. Right? I don't see many faces here which are nodding. So let me explain that a little bit more. What do I mean by secular? The logic of secular or the logic of modern, we usually call it secular modern, right? Secular modernity. What is the problem with secular modernity? One is that it creates a notion of the public and private, except it has historical contradictions. What does the secular modernity offer us? It offers us equality. It offers us freedom. Now, both are, as has been proved by time and again, impossible. There cannot be equality, all right? There cannot be equality because somebody to be modern, somebody has to be pre-modern. Not everybody can be modern at the same time. So when we struggle and reach modern, they become post-modern. When we struggle and reach, who is they? When we struggle and become post-modern, they become post-post-modern. So there is no catching up in the whole logic of modernity itself. There is no way we can catch up with them, because somebody has to be, in the whole binary logic, somebody has to be always outside or before the modern and the pre-modern. So in a way, we have to rethink these notions of secularism as well as modernity, just not just the notion of nation itself. Because then we slowly realize that the notion of secularism and modernity then are logic of capital itself. Right? This is the logic of capitalism itself. So that we see an assertion of equality. Everybody wants equality. And when I say this, people look completely shocked. I say, I don't want equality. I say equality is impossible. The same way secularism is impossible, equality is impossible because we are all different. We can only have equality by erasing difference. We can only have equality by erasing difference. The simplest example which I usually use is my grandfather. My grandfather used to have, not because he was a feudal lord or anything, but at those days, doctors and tailors went to homes. So the tailor will come to his house and take his measurement and make a shirt for him. He doesn't have to fit into 40 or 42 or 44 because he was 40 and a quarter or 43 and a quarter. No shirt is made for 40, 41 or 43 or a quarter. So we are again fixed, forced to fit into categories created by modernity. And we always exceed them. We do not fit into either so-called modern or so-called secular or any of these forms. So in a way, what we are encountering then is this what has been called the hyphenated category, that we are increasingly becoming erasing an attempt to erase the difference which usually is hyphenated, and most of us are hyphenated. I mean, we will not even go to proper names and names, etc. We are all hyphenated. Nobody is 42 or 44. As a result, we all live our lives as misfit. My shirt never fits because I am not 44. I must be 43 and a three-fourths or something. So what modernity requires, the logic of modernity then requires for a simple governance to people to become modern, and modern then becomes the logic of capital to erase differences, right? And to surpass religion and to live in a so-called secular frame. And what is secular? Secular, simply put, says that the prime minister is greater than God. In the European context, it basically says that the king is greater than Pope. This was a negotiation between Pope and the king, between secular and sacred authorities. So the whole birth of secularism, as I'm sure all of you know, by Tala Lazad, etc., is itself a creation. Secular itself is a creation of sacred. Secular is born out of this historical, what you call, conflict in Europe. So to say that, sometimes I rush through and I don't explain enough. In such case, can we take questions or something? If I'm running through something very quickly and you need a clarification, please raise your hand and raise it so I can go back to that. So, okay, we established that there's a return of religion, one. Then that there is a way in which differences are crucial. Differences are not to be seen as a threat. Differences are to be respected. The whole idea of difference is crucial to human survival and existence. It is not by becoming all of us becoming same. We are all wearing same kind of shirts, same kind of becoming. There is a uniformization. A uniformity is being imposed, and this, as a result, creates all kind of modern anxieties of its own, where people do not feel at home in their own lives because they are not living in their lives. Right? That is 20 minutes. Okay, so the larger claim I'm making then, in terms of thinking beyond, is to rethink secularism itself. To rethink secularism, we have to rethink the whole notion of nation itself. To rethink nation, we have to look at a nation as a historical formation, a historical concept, not an eternal concept. It is there, it was not there before, it may not be there later on. So to think beyond nation, we have to rethink categories of secular and modern itself. So I say that, I always make this a proclamation, that increasingly we are living in a world which is post-secular, post-modern, and post-national. That the only way we can escape this national anxiety of difference. National anxiety is basically about difference. I'm not even talking about hegemony, etc. All kind of other issues are there. But in a larger frame, the national anxiety, the only way we can actually think beyond is to think beyond secular, think beyond nation, think beyond even modernity per se. That is not to say to reach postmodernity, not at all. There is a clever way of putting it, that is to say that to think the basis of modernity itself. Or let me put it this way, if you can, there's a formulation by, to think the modern formulation of modernity. Not to reach postmodernity quickly, to think about the modern formulation of modernity itself. What will be the modern? So modern comes with a notion of individual, etc., etc. To rethink so those formations, which have become the ethic of modernity itself, the modern formulation. So not rushing to postmodernity at that one jump, but to always posit a post-secular life, right? Okay, I have kind of prepared for 25-30 minutes strictly. So then one of the claims that I make then, okay, this much is clear, right? So we are dealing with an internal enemy and an external enemy. In terms of Indian context, the notion of Pakistan and the notion of minority within. And in a sense, the minority can be seen as a construction of modernity itself. So there is a way in which, that is very simple to understand, how minority is a construction of modernity. Minorities don't exist non-historically, right? So something what modernity does in its enlightenment, the bringing the light of reason, is to start codifying the whole data collection. So unless you know how many people are in this room and who do they belong, there is no notion of majority or minority. It is only, and to put it very simply, as Fanon has said, as Ambedkar has said, that it's only when you go out of your ghetto that you realize that you are a black or you are a caste. If you are living among blacks, you are not a black. It is only in the encounter of the other, the outside, the inside-outside binary, that you become what you are. So it is only by a construction of majority that a minority is created. Minorities don't exist non-historically. It is when a majority was constructed, willy-nilly, there will be a construction of minority per se. So in that sense, minority then becomes a construction of modernity. Clear enough, right? So one of the things which I have been arguing recently is that if you look back at the past 30 years of our work, and if you look back at the past 30 years of the most significant, important work in India, it seems to have been coming from the umbrella, under the umbrella of something called cultural studies, right? Now, what is cultural studies? Cultural studies is a discipline which is not a discipline, or it is interdisciplinary. You could do cultural studies in combat literature, in English literature, in sociology, in politics, in history, etc., etc. So it is an interdisciplinary kind of approach, a method, cultural studies. So past 30 years of the work has been, and what do culture do? This is the major argument where I've been formulating, and I'll end with that. If there are any immediate questions, I will take them, or later also. In terms of, I know that I rushed through, not clarified probably enough. So the past 30 years of important work, significant work from India, forget the world, from India has been coming under the umbrella of something called culture studies. Now, culture is usually associated with something very, very near to you. You're born into a culture. You're born into a religion. You probably cannot choose your culture. Right? Earlier, people were talking about assimilation, how Iranians came to Tamil Nadu and then became, or Maharashtra, etc. How outsiders, people who are from outside, had come to India and then become assimilated as Indians. But even in that assimilation, there will be something which remains as part of they being Persian or whatever. So culture is not something that you can opt for. That is something you're born in, right? And culture is very intimate. Culture always can provoke you. If you are hurt, insulted, your culture is hurt or insulted, you could become really provoked. There's something very, very, very innate and very dear about culture. Now, what I'm proposing is that what has happened in the past 30 years when we have learned to assert ourselves, as Dalits, as Muslims, as women, etc., as all kind of formations. And this is a comma category, a hyphenation. It will continue. More and more people will be asserting. Now, what has happened while we are asserting is that we have sometimes forgotten the larger frame. and we have sort of emptied this larger frame, which hence is now occupied by all kind of different kind of people who are making large civilizational claims on our behalf. So what I am pushing to that we, it is not to deny the world of culture, not to deny the importance, political significance of practicing cultural studies, but to say that while we do that, we should not lose track of something larger, which is a civilizational argument. And the civilizational argument need not necessarily be a national argument. So Muslims in India therefore embody, and I'm going to turn this around, we have always been accused of pan-Islamic. I mean, I'm saying yes. I'm saying why not? We will be pan-Islamic. India was born when? 1947. Islam has been there much before and much later also. That is not to say that we are a threat to India or we are against India. Not at all. In fact, I'll put it this way, that there is a level in which we belong here, but we also belong elsewhere. And this is true of everybody. Civilization is something that you can espouse, you can become. Now, let me put it, if you are worried about it, this is exactly what Ambedkar said when Ambedkar was talking about Buddhism. Ambedkar's positing of Buddhism is a civilizational claim. Buddhism is not Indian, or not just Indian. Buddhism belongs to the world. Muslims belong to the world also. And what we will then do, that is not to say that our interests lie outside. No, our interests lie here. And what we will do is that we will use our culture to critique the civilizational argument, but we will also use the civilizational claim or argument to critique the given culture as well. So in a way, both should start working dialogically. Now the danger is that because we have emptied the space of civilization, other elements are speaking for us, the so-called Indian civilization. Let me put it to you that Western civilization is a misnomer. There is no Western civilization, which is what we are constantly being upheld against. Western civilization. Western civilization doesn't exist. Western civilization is a logic of capital. Now, I can explain this much more detail later. There could be an English civilization, British civilization, even an American civilization, or all kind of, even a European one. But there cannot be a Western civilization, because Western civilization is the logic of modernity. It's the logic of capital. It is not a civilization at all. It does not have the civilizational values. Right? Whereas there is Indian civilization. Let us not be singular about the Indian civilization. Let's say that India has not just cultures, but even civilizations. And they can coexist. Recently, even RSS has come around to the position, right? If you remember, RSS has recently made a proclamation that similar kind of argument that there are no others here. We are all here. And we can have not just one belonging, we can have multiple belongings. The more houses I have, the richer I am. Why should I only be housed in one? I have this house, I also have that house. I'm not talking about triple talak, okay? But definitely houses, it enriches me. I belong not only here, definitely here, but also elsewhere, and why not? And I will have this local as well as global aspirations. Cultural as well as civilizational, national as well as international aspirations. I think that is basically the way to think beyond. Now, what we then do is not to say that, so we are secular or supposedly secular, we'll become religious. No, I think it is a false binary. Because in the quick argument of Gyanendra Pandey, he has shown that how secularism breeds communalism. Instead of seeing as opposite, it is the excessive demand of becoming secular, which people cannot. Then people are immediately, increasingly being labeled as communal. Right? I can end by quoting Muhammad Ali, not the Jinnah, the Maulana Muhammad Ali, who said that, I must have quoted it, who said, told Nehru that, see Nehruji, my communalism is more secular than your secularism. Thank you.